I'm going to talk more about what Chris was calling design-based applied econometric work. I think we'll complement the lecture you heard from Chris, as well as the lecture that you heard from Chao Fu, that I unfortunately missed yesterday because I was not feeling well, but which I have heard in previous years and thought was exceptionally good. It's titled, so there's going to be two parts of this. The first part is titled Heterogeneous Treatment Effects, but it's really broader than that, I would say. It's just issues I think of as being important in the world of design-based program evaluation for treatment effects. So there'll be some structural program evaluation here too. The second part after the break, depending on how rapidly I go, will be about a somewhat narrow issue, which is so-called within-study designs. And within-study designs are designs that use experiments, that use randomized controlled trials as benchmarks to evaluate the performance of non-experimental identification strategies employed with particular data in particular programming contexts. And that literature has been very influential in labor economics. Perhaps oddly less influential in other parts of economics. And my view, which I will push on you in the latter part of my talk, is that much of the literature misinterprets what the within-study designs actually have to tell us. And that if you interpret them correctly, they provide valuable lessons from the lessons that many scholars have taken from. Before I begin, a little bit of biography, or intellectual biography, I guess. This is designed to guide you in deciding whether or not to drop by my office hours this afternoon. Plus, it may help you understand where I'm coming from, but I do. I was trained at Chicago with Mr. Ekman. I have a bunch of papers, many papers with Mr. Ekman, but a lot of papers not with Mr. Ekman. Some of them are all I think we sat down at one point and tried to figure out who had the most with Jim, that it wasn't me. But I'm up there. Maybe Jim Walker is the top. I don't know.
Definitely not me.
Not you? Some of the work is on social experiments. So randomized controlled trials in a kind of developed country context. I have a lot of methodological work on non-experimental methods, especially matching weighting estimators and regression discontinuity designs. Some of this stuff is correct, some of this stuff is not. The substantive context for most of this discussion, as well as for these two discussions down here, is active labor market programs. Active labor market programs are programs that provide services to disadvantaged workers, unemployed workers, to try to help them be more successful in the labor market. That could be job search assistance, that could be training in a specific occupation. There's a vast literature that studies those programs in a developed country context. There's a smaller, but still interesting literature that studies them in a developing country context. I have another literature, most of this is with my friend Dan Black at the Harris School in Chicago and my student, Eleanor Dillon at Arizona State, on university quality and academic match. So what happens when weak students go to good universities, good students go to weak universities? That's a live policy issue in the US right now. Combating that mismatch. I have a couple papers on what the literature calls statistical treatment rules. So statistical treatment rules attempt to use statistical models to determine who should receive or who should not receive a particular program or service. And I have a slide or two in here about those. And then I have some work on performance management. Now you can think about this as personnel economics applied to institutions. So in the US and in many other developed countries, many government bureaucracies are guided by quantitative measures of performance. And so, in many communist countries, they are too. Everything is guided by performance management under communism in some sense. But in the US, this takes the form of things like local offices of a job training program may be evaluated based on the fraction of the people they train who get jobs after the training. And training centers that place lots of people will get more money than training centers that don't place lots of people will get less money. That's performance management. And there's a whole literature in economics on that. Some of that's with Jim, some of that's not. All right, here's my ambitious outline. I have the same disease that Chris has, that I always believe I'm not going to have enough slides, contrary to all empirical evidence and past experience. So I know in advance that I have way too many slides. Some of these skips along the way. I'm going to try to speak in my slow voice, and in the hope that whatever slides I do get through, the message actually gets across. I think that's more important than making sure that every slide appears up here. You will get the slides from Valerie at some point. Notation, parameters of interest, experiments require assumptions. I'll explain why that is perhaps a surprising idea. Then a bunch of stuff on heterogeneous impacts. I will discuss the heterogeneous treatment effects in the context of experimental data just because it makes it easier. Right? We have a randomized trial, we have solved the problem of non-random selection into the treatment, and we can just focus on worrying about the heterogeneity of treatment effect. I'll say some words about external validity. You can see there's a potpourri aspect to this talk. That will be, I think, similar in spirit but different in form than what Chris had to say. I will say, and this is going to be postponed until the second talk, I'll say a little bit about general equilibrium evaluation. That's where the explicitly structural stuff will come in. And then I will conclude, and then we'll take a break and go on to the limited studies on. Now, the last two times I did this in Beijing, the second talk was about matching estimators. I decided that was too broad for an hour. That's why I'm substituting this talk about within study designs. I first tried this at the Chicago version of the course last summer. I'm going to give a version of it in Australia in a week as my keynote lecture at the Australian conference becomes. So your reactions will be useful in thinking about how to frame that keynote lecture. All right, notation. You've all seen Y1 and Y0. So Y is some outcome variable, earnings, age, first marriage, something like that. Y1 is the outcome in the treated state. Maybe you were a bad class person, as I was just discussing with one of you. Y0 is the outcome in the untreated state. Maybe you're a good class person. The treatment effect for a given unit is the difference between what they would experience in the treated state and what they would experience in the untreated state. The fundamental problem, of course, is that we don't observe both those things. If everybody had their Y1 and Y0 tattooed on their forehead, then anybody could do program evaluation, because it would be very easy. You could just read off the forehead, hit the Y1 and Y0, subtract them, and you know that individual treatment effect. But that's not how it works. In point of fact, we only ever observe one of Y1 and Y0 for each unit. The program evaluation problem is trying to come up with ways to approximate means of these things that we observe for only some of the units. This has various names in the literature. This is very much a Heckmanism here, right? So this is Don Rubin. Don Rubin is a very famous statistician. In certain circles, this framework is called a Rubin causal model, or the RCM. If you pick up the Emmons of Rubin book on causality, they're calling it the Rubin causal model. Other people in statistics who don't like Rubin call it the Neyman-Rubin model. Neyman was an early 20th century statistician. Heckman used to call it the Fisher-Neyman-Roy-Quant-Rubin model. So Fisher's another early 20th century statistician who studied randomized trials. Roy, you heard about from Chris. Roy is Heckman's favorite model, too. quant develops switching regressions, which have a close connection with what's going on in the human effects world. So these two emphasize the fact that this notion is implicit, and to some degree explicit, and really this is a debate about exactly what we mean by this, and exactly how explicit it has to be for it to count. These people are writing 20 years before Rubin. These people are writing 60 years before Rubin. Robert Frost is an English poet. He wrote a poem called The Road Not Taken. That sure sounds like Y1 and Y0 to me. I went to a lecture by somebody who had picked up on this idea. They had found a quote from John Stuart Mill, even before Frost, so a quote from the 1800s, that basically laid out this notion of counterfactuals. I'm sure you could find something, if you cared to, from some Greek philosopher that laid out the notion of counterfactuals. Anyway, you get the idea. I'm going to use D to be an indicator for participation in the program. This is another way to identify papers by Heckman students, is that they tend to use D for the program participation indicator rather than T. And I'm going to let R be an indicator for randomization into the treatment group in an experiment. The usual parameter of interest in the vast majority of program evaluation studies that you might read is the impact of treatment on the treated. So what is that? That's the expected difference between the treated outcome and the untreated outcome conditional on treatment, so for the treated units. If we want to do a cost-benefit analysis of a program that says keep it as it is or kill it, that's the parameter that we want. We want to compare the benefits of the people currently in the program to the cost of running the program as it currently is. This is sometimes abbreviated as ATET or TOT or ATP or yes. All the same. In the experiment, this is sort of what you get by the randomization, right? The experiment takes people with D equals one, the people who wanted to be in the program, that showed up at the door of the program and said, I want to be in the program. And it randomly forces some of them, we call those people who've been randomly forced to not receive the program, the control group, it randomly forces some of those people who wanted to be in the program to experience the untreated outcome. That's the beauty of experiments, is this force part, right? You let people reveal that they're D equals one type, and then you randomly force some of them to experience the untreated outcome. All right, Larry just wandered off. This is for Larry to some degree. I just kind of put up the model. I find this model super helpful. And it's not a deep model, very simple model. Oftentimes simple models are very useful. I'm tempted to say that a little theory goes a long way, but I don't mean to say that in their stochastic sense. It's just that as with the Roy model, which is also a very simple model, simpler than this, you can learn a lot even from really simple models. And this is a model that captures not everything that's going on in the literature on evaluating, say, job training programs, but a lot of it. So the model is going to have two parts. It's going to have a, and this model comes from Heckman and Robb, 1985. It's also in Heckman and Lana Smith, 1999. That's the handbook chapter in the handbook of labor economics. And a somewhat updated version of this model appears in my recent handbook chapter with my Michigan colleague, Brian McCall, and my friend, Switzerland, Connie Munch. So we have an outcome equation here. Outcome y depends on some covariates. I specify a parametric linear form here. You don't have to do that. If Jim were up here, we'd have another line up here that started super general, and then we would move the error term outside the super general functional form, and then we would specify a linear form. I'm just going to write the linear form. But I encourage you in practice to always try to be flexible about your functional forms. Then I have an additive treatment effect. But here I've made the model more general than it's usually written down. How is this model more general than it's usually written down? The beta term here, which is multiplying the treatment indicator, has an I subscript. So 99% of program evaluation papers, maybe 90% now, 99% integrating over history, implicitly assume that the coefficient on the treatment indicator has no I subscript. That is a common treatment effect. I'm putting that I subscript there as my way of signaling I want to think about this thing as potentially being different for each unit R. I also have allowed here for a unit-specific intercept, so A to I. And then there's a transitory error component, epsilon I, T. You might want to think by epsilon I, T as potentially being serially correlated. Not perfectly so, or it could be in data I, but perhaps a kind of AR1 process. So it's going to capture shocks that are persistent, but not permanent. If we have monthly data, and we're studying employment outcomes, this is almost certainly not going to be independent over time, because lots of labor market phenomena last longer than a month, both their observed parts and their unobserved parts. This is the switching regression representation of the data. Right, so what we observe, YIT, is Y1IT if you are treated, and it's Y0IT if you are not treated. That's the link back to quant here. And this is a reminder, we only ever get one of these. That's why this is hard. I'm going to assume that treatment appears only once. It appears in period K. So time is running along. There's one period, we'll call it period K. I was regretting when I was looking at this morning that I also had beta K and XK here. That's different K. Treatment appears only once in period K, and it's unexpected. Right? That allows me to get away with this simple model. If I had people who were looking forward to treatment, and I wanted to worry about that explicitly in my study, then I would perhaps want to do a dynamic discrete choice model or something like that, where I explicitly took into account the fact that people anticipate the future availability of brain. I don't want that. I want to keep this very simple. If you want a version of the model that does that, there's a version cast in the context of a dynamic discrete choice model in the McCall, Smith, and Wundt-Hendrick chapter. So, the training opportunity shows up as a surprise in period K. Each agent has to decide whether to do it or not. We'll have that equation on the next slide. If they choose to do training, then their outcome in period K is zero. That's designed to reflect the fact that if we think about this as earnings, if you're in the training program, you can't also be working. Right? So there's an opportunity cost here to the training. The opportunity cost is I don't get any earnings if I train. So Y1IK is zero. I give up Y0IK to do training with the idea that then in future periods, I'll get beta DI, and that will eventually make up for my opportunity cost in period K. All right, so this is also simple in a way that we're going to relax later on. In that the treatment effect is not explicitly dependent on observed covariates. So I haven't put any explicit subgroup effects in here. Maybe men have different effect of training than women. People who finish high school have a different effect of training than people who dropped out, whatever. We'll talk about those kind of subgroup effects later. For the moment, they are not here. Here is the participation equation. This is very similar in spirit to the sector choice equation that Chris put up in the context of the joy model example. So we're deciding now, it's period K, suddenly this training opportunity arises. I've got to decide whether to take this training or not. There may be some costs, CI, for taking the training that vary across people. That's why it has an I subscript. Those costs may be monetary, like travel costs to get to the training center, or they may be psychic costs. Some people like sitting in classrooms, people like you. Other people do not like sitting in classrooms, but we're not here. There is the opportunity cost of training, right? The earnings that you would get in period K if you decide not to do the training. Those are gonna vary across people too. And then the treatment effect. Beta DI should matter too. Some people may get a lot of earnings gain out of training. Some people may not get much earnings gain out of training, or may even be made worse off. You can think about this right-hand side here, and this is everything else that we don't observe. So Larry and I were talking at the break about whether or not we think there's probability in the universe. I guess my usual thought is there is none, that what this error term represents, although we model it as being a random variable and think about probabilities, that really it's a whole bunch of other things that we just don't observe that they're effects. And we make some assumptions about the net effect of those other things that take the form of a probability assumption. Oh, yes. I assume the way I've written this, that individuals know their beta DI exactly. A more subtle model, a more realistic model, would be that they have some beliefs about what their beta DI is. Maybe those beliefs are good, maybe they're not. Right? Some of you I know are thinking about going on a PhD program. You don't know the treatment effect of the PhD program on you with certainty, but you have probably thought about it and tried to think about whether it's bigger or smaller or not in making that decision. Notice here that this model of participation embodies three kinds of potential selection into the program. We can get selection on cost. Right? We'd expect that all else equal, people for whom C is low are more likely to participate than people for whom C is high. Selection on the opportunity cost. Right? So the untreated outcome. We would expect people who, you know, it's pre-K, the training opportunity shows up, but things just got really good at work. They're not going to take the training program. They have a high opportunity cost. On the other hand, people just got laid off, they have a low opportunity cost. They're the ones who are going to go and take the training program. And finally, we expect selection on the treatment effect. On people with bigger treatment effects, all else equal, we would be expected to be more likely to participate than people who believe that their treatment effect is going to be small. Now, historically, in the common effect model, you're not worried about that part. Right? If you think about the original Heckman selection model, right, the Bivariate normal model, which can be estimated with the Heckman two-step estimator, that model is all about selection on the unobserved component of the untreated outcome. There is a generalization of it, which is the trivariate normal model in Bjorklund and Moffitt in 1987. The best example of a paper that was written too early, I think, that I know of. Their model generalizes to have a normally distributed treatment effect. But the basic model that people were using for a very long time, because they were thinking of common treatment effects, did not have this in there, which is perhaps surprising. I mean, in an economic sense, you think, why are people going to go into a program? Because they think it's going to benefit them a lot. Why are they not going to go in? Because they don't think it's going to benefit them very much. But the whole focus of the literature up until about 50 years ago was the opportunity cost rather than the impact. Question. And like Chris, I'm quite happy to be interrupted. As I said, you both got trained in Chicago. Chicago has this culture of aggressive interruption. You don't need to be aggressive, but please feel free to ask questions when they come. Assuming that the beta DIs, the D subscript, are independent of everything else in the model, and that they are known to agents, what are the impacts of any, implications? It's amazing how you discover, I've been through this thing three times, right? Four times, maybe, between yesterday and today. And there's a new type of. Anyway, what are the implications for the simple model for the relative magnitudes of the average treatment effect on the treated, the average treatment effect on the population, and the average treatment effect on the non-treated? They have a clear ordering in the simple model. Because of the selection of the treatment effect, we expect this to be bigger than that, to be bigger than that. Right? This is just the weighted average of this and this. If there's selection into the treatment based on having a bigger than average treatment effect, that's got to be bigger than this, since this is the weighted average of the two. Well, there's an implication, right, already, that average treatment effect of the treated is going to be different than the average treatment effect of the non-treated. If what we're interested in is not a decision to keep or kill a current program, but a decision to take a current voluntary program and make it mandatory. So to go from treating only individuals who self-select to treating everybody. Right? And what we really care about is this. But this may be very different than this, if there is selection on the index. And then it becomes really critical to get some sense of the extent to which people know something about their index. This is a very open research area. There's only a handful of papers that really directly address this question of the extent to which individuals know the impact of treatments they undertake. There you go. Paper. All right, talk about that. Some econometrics. When can we just run a regression? Right, so let me put that differently. I like to distinguish between identification strategies and estimators. This has become a sort of pedantic thing of mine lately. The literature is often very loose about the distinction between identification strategies and estimators. What do I mean by that? Well, suppose I'm going to assume the conditional independence assumption. Conditional independence assumption, not the spy agency, conditional independence assumption, says that once I condition on X, D doesn't tell me anything about the composite error term. That's a very strong claim about the X. Right? The conditional dependence assumption allows me to make causal interpretation of the coefficient on D. The exogeneity assumption, right? If you look at the Woolbridge undergraduate text, for example, which I teach out of in my undergraduate econometrics class, it's all about this. This allows me to make a causal interpretation of every right-hand side variable. But I'm not actually interested in making causal interpretations about the coefficients on the x's. They're there only to make the conditional dependence assumption plausible. Right? What I really want to make a causal claim about is D. Right? You can see this very clearly in a randomized trial. Right? In a randomized trial, people typically condition on X when they're estimating the outcome equation, even though they don't have to. Right? You've done random assignments, you can just compare means. You put the X in there to make your estimates more precise because they soak up residual variance. But you don't interpret the coefficients when the X's is plausible. Because the randomization has only given you the CIA. It hasn't given you exogeneity. It is important to make an explicit case, ideally motivated by a model. A model can be in your head, it doesn't have to be written down. But you want to make an explicit case for the covariates you're including, if you have done a randomized trial, as to why the reader should think that they possibly satisfy the CIA. That's very important. And thinking about how units come to select the treatment in a formal way, if not an explicit mathematical way, is a very good way to think about what X's you're going to need to have to make this plausible. Good. So if you don't want to do identification with the conditional dependence assumption, so if you've thought about it and you don't think you have the right X, that's often going to be true. Maybe you want to do instrumental variables. Chris talked a little bit about instrumental variables, although not so much in a treatment effects context. Then maybe you want to find a cost-based measure. So a lot of instrumental variable strategies essentially vary C. They look for variation in C that's unrelated to other stuff. So distance to college, in the famous paper by David Carr, for example. I don't necessarily want to defend distance to college. Or think about Bill Evans' bus engine paper. Right? So Bill Evans has a paper, I think with a student of his, that wants to look at the effect of prenatal care on child outcomes. The variation he uses is whether or not the pregnancy occurred during a bus strike. That the bus strike made it much more expensive for some mothers to get to the prenatal care. And so arguably, right, it changed C in a way that was independent of other things in the model. The model can also help you think about, was it an instrument or not? And Why am I confused?
Even the simple model of...
You can also think about bias stability in the context of the simple model. Right? So bias stability is the name that actually the statistics literature gives to the identification assumption that underlies the difference of differences estimator. Right? A lot of people just say, oh, difference of differences identification. Difference of differences is an estimator. Just like regression is an estimator. Conditional dependence assumption is where identification is coming. In the context of the model, what is bias stability going to give you? Bias stability assumed and then W is the difference in differences, differences out to A to I. So if you think that the conditional dependence assumption holds for epsilon, but it doesn't hold for epsilon plus theta, then you can do difference in differences because then you will difference out problematic theta. But that's a bold assumption in some context. Right, because it says that all of the differential selection, all of the potential selection bias, results from time invariant differences between the treated units and untreated units, rather than from transitory differences between the treated units and the untreated units. This is why I wanted to show you some data. So what is this? This is page 318 of the Economic Journal in July 1999. This paper is Heckman and Smith, 1999. We think of it as, or I think of it as the Ashley-Felter-Diff paper, and indeed the original version of it was called Ashley-Felter-Diff, blah, blah, blah. And then we sent it to the American Economic Review when Ashley-Felter was the editor, and we thought that if we put his name in the title, it would increase our chances of having the paper accepted. And perhaps it did, but it did not move the latent index above the threshold. And so we were rejected. And then we sent it to the Economic Journal, where Costas McGarrett was the editor at the time, and indeed he suggested to Jim that we sent it there. But he demanded that we take Ashley-Felter's name out of the title. And so the paper it published is called the pre-programmed tip of the line. Anyway, what do we got here? Don't worry about this upper line. What I want to talk about are these two lower lines. So this is data from a big experimental evaluation of a program in the United States called the Job Training Partnership Act. And month T here, for the experimental units, is the month of random assignment. So people showed up to the training center and said, oh, I want to be in JPPA, and they were randomly assigned to a treatment group, which was allowed to take JPPA, and a control group, which was not. We realigned them all in relative time, so that's always month T for those people, whatever month that was. As part of the JPPA evaluation, and we'll hear more about this after the break, they collected ideal comparison group data on eligible non-participants, or ENPs, at 4 of the 16 sites in the experiment. So here we have graphed the control group from those 4 sites and the eligible non-participants from the 4 sites. What lessons do I want you to take away from this? Well, first of all, what you see, so this goes back a year and a half, 18 months, these are monthly earnings. So you can see this phenomenon here, this is the control group. So the graph looks exactly the same for the treatment group because they're random assignments. This is actually Felter-Diff. Right, so there's this gradual decline in the mean earnings of the D equals 1 units in the period prior to their choice to participate in the training. This other line, by the way, well, let's ignore this step. Down here, this is the control group. And these are the ENT there again. So this is the development and development. Oh wait, this is the ENT. Sorry, this is the ENTs. This is the control group. Control group experiences actually felt their dip. The ENTs consist of equal or D equals 0 people. They never participated in JPPA, at least during this window. But they were determined to be eligible for JPPA in month T. Notice that they have no difference, right? Flat. Notice, too, that there is a level difference, which we see for the men, but not so much for the women, between the D equals 0 and D equals 1 individuals. So the way I think about this, and I'm being a little simple here, but to try and highlight how this maps back into the model, right, you could sort of think about this as selection on the time invariant component, and this is selection on the epsilon, which is serially correlated. Right? If epsilon wasn't serially correlated, and there was selection on it, then this would just bounce along and go down in one period. But it goes down slowly. And what it actually represents, if you look at the underlying microdata, is lots of individual patterns that look like that. Right? It's that individuals lose their job and go to zero. But those people who lose their job become more and more frequent among the participants as you get closer, which is why the aggregate pattern looks like a smooth fall, even though basically no individuals experience a smooth fall. Individuals experience abrupt falls. So, what I want you to take away from this. Comparing d equals 0 and d equals 1, what did we learn? A couple things. We learned that there appears to be, for the men, selection on A to I, with a time invariant difference. There is selection on the epsilon IT, which appears to be serially correlated. That means that difference in differences is going to be problematic because it's going to depend on what we picked for the before period, what kind of answer we get at. Right? Difference in differences, building on biased stability, would like it to just look like this. Right? Parallel trends in the period beforehand, they're not parallel. If you go back, you can go back a little further, they're pretty parallel, but then the dip comes along starting at about t minus 12, and they're no longer parallel because of the selection on the transitory shock. This also tells you that you're going to want to be very careful about conditioning on labor market outcomes in the period prior to the participation decision if you want to have any hope of the conditional independence assumption being plausible in these data. And indeed, you can show this empirically by doing it within study design, which I will talk about in the second half of the lecture. Any questions about this before? So I told you the model packs a wallop, right? That's a pretty simple model, two equations. And yet it accounts for a whole bunch of phenomena that's going on in these real data. And it helps us think about choosing an econometric identification strategy. Okay. Slight change of pace here. Experiment. There are people who like experiments and there are people who don't like experiments. I guess my thought is that experiments are very useful things. That, you know, at some level, exogenous variation can never make you worse off if you use it in a reasonable way. We can debate about how many resources should be devoted to producing this particular kind of exogenous variation. We can debate about whether certain experimental papers are good or bad, but in that sense, they kind of got to be good. If you go back to when Heckman and I were writing the Journal of Economic Perspectives paper, came out in 1995, which was about experiments, called Accessing the Case for Social Experiments, and we were paired with another paper by Gary Berlitz. And Berlitz also wrote another paper in the JHR with Larry Orr. They were the pro-experiment side, and we were kind of not the anti-experiment side, but the slightly skeptical experiment side, let's say. One of the points we made, which I think is now pretty well understood, but which was not really well understood at the time by some of the people advocating for randomized trials, is that experimental evaluations require assumptions too. And as Chris pointed out in his discussion, it's kind of always a good idea to know what your assumptions are before you go for it. So what kind of assumptions do experiments require? The first one is that there isn't any randomization bias. What is randomization bias? Randomization bias is the difference between the world of the experiment and the parallel world with no experiment in the way that people behave around the coverage. That can take two main forms empirically. One form is that experiments typically require a whole bunch of bureaucracy. Right? So there's this paper by Barbara C. Macy, one of the co-authors of PSMATCH 2, looking at an experiment in the UK called ERAD. And there, they required people who were going to be randomized to sign a consent form and to sign a form saying that the evaluation confused their data. If they had not done the experimental evaluation of ERAD, they would not have required people to sign those two forms. They would have just taken their data and they wouldn't have randomized them, of course, because they wouldn't have been doing an experiment. Requiring people to sign those two forms causes some fraction of participants not to participate in the program. They don't want to sign the forms. So you change the population under study by doing an experiment relative to what it would have been if you had done a non-experimental evaluation. And she argues in this paper that it's actually the people you select out don't have the same impact as the people who selected. It's a very nice paper, presently under revision for some journal to send it to me. This is different. Oh, the second way these manifest, or could manifest, and this we know less about, is that experiments ought to deter the people who are risk averse. Right? If I know there's an experiment going on and I'm risk averse, maybe I don't go apply for the program, but I would have applied if I'd known I could get into a certainty. Or it could be that there's complementary investments that I might undertake before the program. The fact that I don't know with certainty that I will get in may reduce my effort in the complementary investments by reducing their expected payoff. Those two things we don't have evidence of. Randomization bias is different than Hawthorne effects. Right? Hawthorne effects arise simply from the fact of being observed. So they can arise in non-experimental evaluations too if the people being evaluated are in the program being evaluated know that they are being watched. Or John Henry effects, which are named after an American folklore character, where the control group deliberately tries to be better because they know that they are in an experiment and maybe they don't like the treatment. There's a whole little literature, some of which Chris and I worked on together, that worries about what to do when some people in the experimental treatment group don't get the treatment, dropouts or no-shows, and when some people in the experimental control group, and that's back when Holman, Smith, and Kuhn paper, get things that look a lot like the experimental treatment from other sources. In the United States, which has a very decentralized environment of active labor market programs, this is a big issue. It was a big issue in the Job Training Partnership Act experiment. Much more recently, you have done another big experiment called the Workforce Investment Act Gold Standard Experiment, or WGSE. The WGSE has tons of control group substitutes. That complicates interpretation of the experiment. I'm not going to go into that in detail. The literature has figured this out. It does a much better job of this now than it did when we were writing the kind of question. No? Well, I thought I saw you go. Experiments, like all partial equilibrium non-experimental identification strategies, require an assumption that there are no general equilibrium effects. I'm going to return later in the talk to discuss a bit about general equilibrium effects. The statistics literature calls this assumption SUPA. That terminology has come over into the economics literature to some degree. This stands for stable unit treatment value assumption. What does that mean? That means that Y1 and Y0, tattoos on your forehead, Y1 and Y0 don't depend on how many other units get treated or which other units get treated. If you think even for a moment, you can see why that might well be false in some contexts. Right? If a training program in some modest-sized town produces 100 new welders, the market price of welders is going to fall in the town. And that fall in the market price of welders is going to affect the trainees and the non-trainees. Right, the current stock of welders. That's a general equilibrium effect. That's a violation of the stable unit treatment value assumption. There is a small literature that tries to deal with cases where this fails, but basically, what most of the literature does is says, well, this is really hard, therefore it's equal to zero. That's almost always incorrect reasoning, but you can find lots of other places in economics where we reason this way too, that things that are hard must be zero. But it's the bottom line. This slide, experiments have assumptions too. And maybe an even better way to put it is experiments have economics too. As Derek Neal, likes to say, you can run from the economics, but you cannot hide it. Wise words for life. Another short point I want to make is that there's lots of ways to do random climate. And this is important for a couple reasons. First of all, it's important because we're not always just interested in the average effect of treatment on the treated, which is what sort of standard issue random assignment does. Standard issue random assignment takes people who come to be treated and randomly sorts them into a treatment group and a control group. The second reason why this is useful to talk about is that politically, in the US or Canada or a lot of other developed countries, it's often very difficult to have a control group that doesn't get any treatment at all. Right? So some programs have a requirement that they serve everybody that comes to the board in some way. If that requirement is there and it's hard to change the law, then it's hard to have an untreatment control group. Other times, people are just worried that there'll be stories in the newspaper about how those people, those nasty researcher, intellectual, bad people types, are treating people like guinea pigs. And how can this go on? And blah, 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 blah. We need to make America great again. Now, no more research. What can you do? Well, you can do a bunch of different things. And let me highlight just a couple of them that are interesting. One of them is random assignment at the margin. So I have this paper with my friend Dan Black, the late Mark Berger, and their student, Brett Knoll, who I've actually never met in person. No, I've talked to him on the phone. And here, we're randomizing people into an active labor market drug intervention, but we don't randomize everybody. We have a numerical scale that determines, according to the people who run the program, how much each person needs the program, and the people who get randomized are the people at the margin of being treated. So the marginal scores of how much they need the program. The state wasn't willing to randomly assign everybody, but they were willing to randomly assign people at the margin. You get an experimental estimate that corresponds to the estimate that regression discontinuity design, essentially. We have a paper that exploits that parallel. That's nice in a substantive sense because in this particular program, the policy question of interest isn't are we going to get rid of the program or not. The policy question of interest is are we going to expand the budget a little bit or make the budget a little bit smaller? And for that, for those questions, what you want is the effect on the marginal community. Politically palatable and also substantively interesting. That's a powerful combination. There's another line of papers. You know, Inman has a paper on this about randomized encouragement design. So here, instead of randomly assigning people into a RAPID program, you basically randomly change seed, right? You use an experiment to create an instrument, a cost-based instrument. You send people a coupon. Here, you can get to the program for free on the bus. Or here, we'll give you $50 if you come in and show up and learn about the program. These have been underused, I would say. Just highlight those two and go on. All right, now back to the theme of heterogeneous treatment effects. The way we're used to thinking about heterogeneous treatment effects, I think, is twofold. One thing we're used to doing is thinking about an estimand and an evaluation as treatment on the treated, or average treatment effect, or local average treatment effect for doing IV. Implicit in that kind of interpretation is the notion that there is some selection on an unobserved component of a treatment effect. The other thing we're used to doing, which I will talk more about later, is having subgroup effects. So men versus women, high education versus low. What I want to talk about now is a kind of deeper thing, I guess. And it is parameters of interest that reflect heterogeneity of treatment effects that depend on the joint distribution of Y1 and Y0. So all the parameters I listed before, you can get from just the marginal distributions of Y1 and Y0. So again, think about an experiment. What does an experiment give you? The treatment group gives you the marginal distribution of Y1. The control group gives you the marginal distribution of Y0. You can use this marginal distribution and this marginal distribution to get two means. Take the difference in the two means, that gives you the experimental impact. You can use these two marginal distributions to run a regression with a treatment indicator and interact the treatment indicator with subgroup variables. That'll give you your subgroup effects. Suppose, though, that what you're interested in is the variance of the impact. What's the variance of y1 minus y0? The marginal distributions don't give you the variance of y1 minus y0, because to get the variance of y1 minus y0, you need to know the joint distribution. You need to know which y1s go with which y0s. Right? Suppose that y1 is either 100 or 50, and y0 is either 80 or 40, or 90 or 40. Right? Each one is half of each. If the 100s go with the 90s and the 50s go with the 40s, then actually everyone's impact is 10. And the variance of the impact is 0. If the 100s go with the 40s and the 50s go with the 90s, then some people have an impact of plus 60 and other people have an impact of minus 40. Then the variance is very high. Right? You need a joint distribution to tell you which of those cases hold. And what's the problem with that? The problem with that is there's no way to get the joint distribution. That's the problem with that. But you can do some things. In particular, you can do some bounding exercises. So here are some other examples of parameters that depend on the joint distribution. A fraction with a positive or negative impact of the program. The distribution of impacts, not the distribution of outcomes, but the distribution of impacts, the percentiles of that distribution. The variance and the correlation between y1 and y0, which would also be pretty interesting for a Boyle kind of thing. So this paper here, Heckman, Smith, and Clements, 1997, Priestbud goes through and discusses how to use these bounds in the literature. They're called the Frechet-Hofting bounds. Frechet was a French statistician, Hofting was a German statistician. And we go through a whole bunch of other strategies. We sort of think about, well, what are different ways that you can try to learn about or impose structure on the joint distribution of y1 and y0? And for the data that we look at, which is the data from that job training partnership back experiment I described, what do those different strategies give you back in terms of heterogeneous treatment effects? An updated version of that kind of analysis appears in a paper with my student, Mia Chivari, in the 2008 Journal of Econometrics. There's a lot more work to be done here. I'll mention another paper later on along this line. I've been surprised at how well that's been done. So I want to give you a little example here to show you how this works. We're going to apply the Frechet-Hofting bounds in the case of a 2x2 table. So in the case of a binary treatment and a binary outcome. So think about a job training program. And we have, and this is why I need the pens. Tells us in this case, for people who are, say, employed in freedom state, what fraction would be not employed in the control state, and what fraction would be employed in the freedom state? That's three pieces of information, again, because these four have to sum up to one. So we've got two bits of information for the marginal distribution, but we need three, we have three unknown parameters. So what to do? One thing you could do is you could make a substantive assumption. You can say, and you can see this in some papers by Chuck Mansky and John Pepper, for example. You could say, well, maybe in this context it makes sense that the treatment never makes anybody worse off. Right? What does that mean in the context of this 2x2 table? If the treatment never makes anybody worse off, it means that if you're employed in the control state, then you aren't not employed in the treatment state. That's a zero there. Right, now you're good. Now you have two pieces of information and two things you need to know. But you may not be willing to make that kind of substantive assumption in a particular program context. So here's the formula for the Frechet-Hopkins map. Try to get some intuition about them. The upper bound is pretty easy. The upper bound is the min of the CDF of the two marginal distributions. What does that mean? Well, think about the 0, 0 cell here, the non-employed, non-employed cell. The upper bound says that this cell can't have more than 0.2 of the probability, because it has to be less than or equal to the min of 0.2 and 0.4. Right? I can't put 0.3 here because this column as a whole for the treated group only has 0.2 probability. Right? That's what the marginal distribution equaling 0.2 for not employed in the treated state means. This whole column has to add up to 0.2. This 0.4 means this whole row has to add up to 0.4. This cell, thus, can't be any bigger than the smaller of the corresponding row and column. That's pretty intuitive. That's this upper bound here. The lower bound is perhaps a little bit less intuitive. So this says the lower bound is the max of 0. Well, that makes sense. Probability can't be less than 0. And then the sum of the two CDFs minus 1. Why is that? Well, suppose for a moment that instead of the example I'm going to carry through, that this was 0.6 and this was 0.6. So this says that the lower bound is the max of 0.6 plus 0.6 minus 1, that's 0.2, and 0, that's 0.2, right, in my writing table. So this has to be, in this example where both of these marginals are 0.6, this has to be at least 0.2. Why is that? Well, think about it. Suppose if I put 0.1 in here. Then, in order to make this add up to 0.6, this has to be 0.5. In order to make this add up to 0.6, that has to be 0.5. And I've got a problem. Right? My problem is that this plus this plus this is 1.1. And that violates the constraint that the four cell probabilities have to sum to 1. So this is implicitly imposing the constraint that the four cell probabilities have. Now let's do my original example. So, for the lower bound, right, now in my original example, this is 0.2, this is 0.4, so this is 0.6 minus 1 is minus 0.4, and 0, well, the max of that is 0. What's the upper bound? Well, the upper bound is just the min of 0.2 and 0.4. Pretty easy to see that that is. So the Frechet bounds actually trim the possible values in this cell a lot. Right? If we knew nothing, had no information at all, each cell could range between 0 and 1. Imposing the information contained in the two marginal distributions does not point identify the joint distribution. But it does set identify this parameter and tells us it's between 0 and 0.2. That's pretty nice. So we can do that, and we go through and do that in that paper. Actually, we do this very simple example also in the JP paper. What about the continuous case? Mr. Tabor.
So I think I probably asked you this question in 1993 as well when you were writing the paper, but so why do we care? I mean, so I want to decide whether I know the program or not. Mm-hmm. What I know is that I have, if I go through the program, I have a 80% chance of being employed. If I don't go through the program, I have a 60% chance of being employed. And that's all that matters to me. Why do I really care what my probability would have been if I had gotten employed the other way? I mean, all that's really relevant to me is the distribution of outcomes I get in the state of the world that I enter the program, and the distribution of outcomes that I get in the state of the world that I don't enter the program.
I'll give two answers to that. I like that question. So one answer is that a policymaker might be interested in this cell in particular. All right. This is the cell where people are being made worse off. And if there was a possibility that a lot of people are being made worse off, you might want to think about ways to redesign the program so that fewer people are being worse off. All right. That's answer number one. Answer number two is that the 2x2 binary outcome case isn't actually very interesting.
That's not really.
That.
I mean,
there
if you
design
a better program, we should think about designing a better program. If they can come up with a better way to design the program to increase the outcomes for everybody, they should. I don't see why.
You might be concerned about the variance in outcomes as well. Right? So people know what their impact is. These guys know they were made worse off. Somehow they're scarred, and they know it by being in the program. You don't want those guys wandering around because they're not going to vote for you.
But they don't know that they were worse off.
Well, you tell stories
until you told them they were worse off, I guess.
I think the continuous case, I think what is really interesting is the lower bound on the impact variance in the continuous case. So I'm willing to take a point that this is not super interesting. It is super easy to explain, which is why I like it. It's very easy to do the bounds in this case. Let me go to the continuous case, and if you're still unhappy, please express your unhappiness. Aaron's smiling. You see it? Valerie was complaining that the lecture is done on this one.
Oh, very good.
Even though Chris said my slides were more and irrelevant. All right. In the continuous case, now I'm going to think about taking the treatment group. So these are all Y zeros. This is about the limits of my graphic ability, unfortunately, which I'm old. This is the control group. This is the treatment group. If you think about ordering their outcomes, and suppose for the moment they're at equal size, think about ordering their outcomes in order from smallest to largest or largest to smallest. Then each joint distribution consists of a set of links between the two joint distributions. The way we operationalize this in the paper is that we take percentiles and then we link percentiles between the z equals 1 distributions and equals 0 distributions. You can show that the Frechet-Hopkins bounds correspond to two special cases. The lower bound on the impact variance, or the lower bound distribution more generally, corresponds to the case where there is rank preservation. So that your rank in the treated outcome distribution is the same as your rank in the untreated outcome distribution. That's a kind of one-factor model. Right? There's people who do well in treatment land, and there's people who do well in control land, and they are so strongly typed that their ranks are preserved in the two distributions. You remember the example I gave before with the 190, 50, and 40, right? The one case I gave was when the 100s were with the 90s and the 50s were with the 40s. That's the rank correlation case. That is the rank preservation case, where the ranks are the same with the two. And as it did in my little toy example, that minimizes the variance of the impacts. In my example, it minimized it to zero. That doesn't have to be true, but it minimizes it. When are the impacts maximized? They're maximized when you have rank inversion, right? So the best outcome in the treated state corresponds to the worst outcome in the control state. Best outcome in the control state corresponds to the worst outcome in the treated state. That's those arrows there in the middle, right? So these are rank preservation. That's rank inversion. So rank correlations of minus 1 and 1 correspond to the fresh air Hopping value. And you can show that the impact variance is minimized at the lower bound distribution and maximized at the upper bound distribution. That, I think, is interesting. So we have a whole discussion, I guess if you had different co-authors, this would have been a separate paper, in Appendix E of Clemens, 1997. Clemens was a sociology grad student that I imagine Steve Stigler's class on robust estimation. Talked into working with Heckman. I'm not sure she would. Anyway. The Heckman treatment effect also has uses. We talked about how to use the estimated distribution of impacts in the range preservation case to test the null of the zero impact variance, which seems like an interesting null to me. Why is that an interesting null? It's an interesting null because, as I mentioned before, 95% of papers implicitly assume the impact variance is zero, because they implicitly assume a common effect model. It's nice to actually test that. I'm surprised it is not tested more. I imagined at the time that this would lead to it being tested more, and maybe it is tested a little more. There's a kind of interesting econometric issue here, which is that in general it's tricky to test nulls that are at the boundaries of parameter spaces. Right, so what is the parameter space here for the impact variance? It's zero to positive infinity. Right, so it has a boundary at zero because variances can't be negative. So you're testing the null that you want to test, which is the impact variance at zero, is the boundary of the parameter space. To see why that causes trouble, think about what happens. If you're actually in a world where the population variance of the impacts is zero, and you get two samples of data, you do a randomized trial, you've got your treatment group, you've got your control group, you take percentiles, you difference them. In any given draw from that population, even if the population variance of impacts is zero, the variance of the impacts in the sample is not going to be zero, it's going to be positive. Right? And that results from the fact that you're squaring things when you take variances, right? So negative, there's no cancellation. And so you can't just say, okay, you know, there's no sampling distribution around zero, right? The sampling distribution is all starts at zero and is positive. That's the problem with things that round the parameter space. So what we show is that you can get sampling distribution by drawing from the control group only. Right? So in the control group, nobody is treated. So that is a population in which the variance of the treatment effects is zero. So you take draws from the control group to create a faux treated group and a faux control group. Take percentiles, do rank preservation, calculate the variance impacts, do that over and over and over again, and that gives you the distribution of the estimated impact variance under the null of a zero impact variance. And then you take the variance of the impacts that you actually calculated using the real data, where the treatment group did get the treatment, and you place it in that distribution and see what percentile it's at. And that percentile is your p-value. And we do that exercise in Appendix E. And we show that for the JPPA data on adult women, you can reject the null of a zero impact variance. And indeed, the lower bound on the impact variance that we estimate is substantively quite large. The standard deviation of the lower bound on the impact variance is something like, the lower bound on the impact standard deviation is about $800 for earnings over the 18 months after reasonable assignment. That's reasonably large. I think that's interesting. Right, it's kind of an empirical verification. Right? Even though we don't know the joint distribution, even though all we've got are these bounds, we can sort of empirically verify that the common effect null doesn't hold. I think that's kind of cool. All right, quantile treatment effect. These actually turn out to be related to the Fréchet-Hopping bounds as well. Probably some of you have heard of quantile treatment effects. So the idea here is that you're going to take In the simplest case, you've got your treated outcome distribution, you've got your control outcome distribution. You're going to look at, instead of impacts on the mean of the outcome, you're going to look at impact on particular quantiles of the outcome. So you might compare the treatment group median to the control group median. That would be the quantile treatment effect on the median. You might compare the treated distribution 75th percentile to the control group 75th percentile. That would be the quantile treatment effect on 75th percentile. You could think about these in two ways. One way is just impact on quantiles, and this is a very narrow English preposition distinction here, and I understand that. So I'm going to try to make the concept clear. You cannot assume rank preservation and just say, I just want to know what happens, you know, this is just a way of helping you understand what the distribution looks like in the treated world and in the untreated world. So it's impact on quantiles. If I'm willing to assume rank preservation, though, this is impacts at quantiles, because under rank preservation, the person or unit at the median of the treated outcome distribution is the counterfactual of the person at the median of the control outcome distribution. That's not true without rank preservation. And it can be interesting either way, right? If all you care about is how does this affect inequality, you don't really care if it's the same people or different people. You just care about how does the treatment affect the spread of the outcome, then interpretation one is fine. If you would like to make statements about impacts on units at particular places in the distribution, then you need to assume rank preservation. Marianne Fittler, my former colleagues with Dilbach and Louis Hoynes, point out in a very nice paper that you can test an implication of rank preservation. And this is one of those papers where when I read it, I just went, I should have thought of that. that's always a nice paper, right? When it's sort of something you hadn't thought of, and you read it, and it's obvious. And then you're mad, you didn't think of it. But their idea is that if rank preservation is true, then the distribution of baseline covariates, or exogenous covariates, ought to be balanced at different quantiles of the outcome distributions, right? So compare the x's at the different percentiles of the control and treatment group outcome distributions, and they design a formal test of equality in their paper. And if you reject that, then that's evidence against rank preservation. It could, of course, hold even if rank preservation was a hold. So it's a test of an implication of rank preservation, but it's still informative. Now, oddly, so I cite here this 2005 NBR paper, the corresponding published paper leaves out the test. And I asked them about this. I said, why didn't you publish the test? That's the coolest part of the paper. And they said, well, that's not what the editor thought. So the editor made them cut out the test. People have different visions. So the quantile treatment effects under rank preservation are the Frechet-Hopkin lower bound treatment effects. That's the link between the two. So here's some real quantile treatment effects. This is again from Heckman's Smith and Clements, although we don't call them quantile treatment effects in the paper. That's a later terminology. And also, we don't use the terminology rank preservation. That came later too. What we talked about is perfect positive dependence, I think. I doubt that this is rank preservation. So what is this? So these are percentiles of the outcome distribution. This is again adult women in the JPPA program. The outcome variable is earnings in the 18 months after random assignment. So the vertical axis is the quantile treatment effect in earnings in the 18 months after random assignment. I will highlight three things in this graph. First of all, up to the 20th percentile, the quantile treatment effects are zero. Why is that? That's because 20% of the people in the control group have zero earnings in the 18 months after random assignment, and 20% of the people in the treatment group have zero earnings in the 18 months after random assignment. And zero minus zero is zero. So that's these folks, the zeros. Then over almost all the rest of the distribution, this quite surprised us, and it's not actually true for the men in this experiment. The quantile treatment effect is roughly constant at about $800 over 18 months after random. And finally, there's a blip up here in the 95th percentile. this is another way to say that the town effect model doesn't hold here. Even when we minimize the impact variance, right, and this, these are the rank preservation treatment effects, these are different than these. The town effect model. There's another feather going back in Mines papers. They've been very enthused about this quite often in my stuff. And they have a paper that sort of builds in this idea that you might have a common effect conditional on employment. Right? So you can have sort of a zero effect for people who don't actually get a job, and then a common effect, and they talk about that in this little paper. If you're into this stuff, there are a sequence of papers that's actually quite nice. Several papers where I said that we should have written. Questions so far? Yes. Oh, there's a paper. You can write that paper. No one has written that paper. That's good. We just came up with a paper idea. Yes? No? Yeah, I'm not going to solve that problem on the fly. No one's written that paper. So the question was, how do you think about bounds in the context of multi-stage random assignment? Now obviously, you can just focus on the first stage of random assignment and do bounds for that, as we described. Well, and you can take the second one as your starting point and just do that, but it sounded like you wanted to do something more subtle than involve those stages. I have to think about that. I'm not going to solve that problem right now. Let me say a little bit more about quantile treatment effects. And give another, to make a point that has been emphasized in the recent literature and about which there was a lot of confusion, and also to highlight another interesting set of empirical findings. Conditional and unconditional quantiles are different. That's the point I want to make. And this has caused a lot of confusion. So I was involved in something with one of my colleagues called the Michigan Medical School Salary Study. So Michigan is very concerned that men and women on its faculty have similar salaries. And so they have done a series of studies. This was the first one I was involved with, where they take salary information from the administrative data that the university holds, and they run regressions of salary on stuff. And the main variable of interest in stuff is the indicator variable for whether or not you're female. And some of the stuff is things like what department are you in? It turns out in the medical school, what we study here, what department you're in by itself has an R-squared of 0.8. So there's a huge amount of variation just as there would be in an arts and sciences division. Right? The economists are way over here, the administrators are way over here. Turns out, brain surgeons up here, general practitioners down here at medical school. So there's a lot of information in the department. There's stuff about whether you have a PhD or an MD or both, whether you, how long you've been since a PhD, how long you've been at Michigan, blah. So my contribution to this little literature of Michigan of these salary studies was, let's do quantile regressions. That'll be interesting. Instead of just looking at differences in conditional means between men and women, let's look at differences in conditional quantiles. But it's important to recognize that these are conditional quantiles. So my example here is an assistant professor. I'm conditionally might be in the 20th percentile of salaries at the medical school, but conditional on being an assistant professor and having a relatively recent PhD and blah, 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 they may be in the 80th percentile of the conditional distribution. So they may be doing very well for an assistant professor in their department, even if they're doing not so well relative to the unconditional distribution. That's the sense in which the conditional and unconditional quantiles are different. What did we find? And I want to mention, so we have no way, although this is in the works for future studies, of controlling for research output or teaching quality or quantity, even. That would be doable, but we didn't try to do it. So these are not causal at all. They're descriptive, but they're still interesting. What we find is that the overall difference in means is about 3% between men and women. But it turns out in quantile regression that that's all concentrated in the upper conditional quantile. So what seems to be true is that sort of in the lower half of the conditional distribution, men and women look the same. In the upper half, men have a longer tail. And that's pretty interesting in a substantive sense. It says that what's probably going on is not a simple, we pay all the women less. That what's probably going on is something about, well, who gets outside offers and how aggressive are they about that? And if men are more aggressive about outside offers, and if the only people who can get outside offers are people who are in the upper part of the conditional distribution of quality, then the lower half looks the same because those people are just kind of getting the base wage, and the upper half looks different if there's a gender difference in aggressiveness of getting outside offers in favor of men. Right? That's a different story with different implications for what the university should do than a story that just says, oh, every woman is paid less. So this is an example where we're looking at the heterogeneous treatment effects, and again, not causal, just descriptive. An example where that is potentially interesting and useful and can be mapped back into theoretical models of salary determination in professional context. How are we doing on time?
You have 10 minutes before break.
Okay. I'm behind, but actually I'm less behind than I was expecting to be, so I'll take it ahead. No. Another way to pin down the joint distribution. So rank preservation is one way to pin down the joint distribution, or more generally, making some assumption about the rank correlation between the treated outcomes and the untreated outcomes is a way to pin down, or at least narrow, the set of possible joint distributions. Right? So in the rank correlation case, here, there are unique distributions associated with rank correlations of minus 1 and 1. But if you pick and you say, I'm certain that the rank correlation is 0.4, there are in fact an infinite number of joint distributions with rank correlations of 0.4, but it is nonetheless a strict subset of all possible joint distributions if I don't impose the condition of the rank correlation of 0.4. And we illustrate that variation in the paper. That was an interesting programming exercise. A different kind of assumption that you can make, which is very common in some particular literatures in economics and outside of economics, is rank coefficient models. Now, this is a little bit probably abuse of terminology. What I mean here is rank coefficient models where I explicitly assume that the coefficient is independent of treatment status. Right, so I'm going to assume that y1 minus y0 is independent of treatment status. To see why that's useful, think about the following exercise. Suppose, again, I have experimental data. You think simple, you can always take non-experimental data, solve the selection problem, and then do these exercises. The treatment group variance is the variance of y1. Right? That's equal to the variance of y0 plus delta, where delta is my notation here for the treatment effect. So the treated outcome is the untreated outcome plus the treatment effect. If the treatment effect is independent of y0, then that variance is just the sum of the two variances. There's no covariance term. That's the thing that the independence assumption buys me, what I'm calling the random coefficient model. So rearranging, I can get the variance of the treatment effects is just the difference in the outcome variance between the treatment group and the control group. That gives me a specification test. Right? If I estimate this difference and it's negative, that tells me this model is wrong. This variance can't be negative. And it turns out actually for one of the four groups in the JTPA data, the treatment group variance is actually smaller than the control group variance. So we can get this model. Some of you may have heard about HLM, hierarchical model, something that's very popular in the education world. A lot of those models assume that the coefficient on the treatment indicator is independent of everything else in the model. There are models in industrial organization that make that assumption. Yes, sir?
Go back a slide. You're making an additional assumption, too, I think, right? Which isn't it the variance of y1 minus y0 is independent of the variance of y0? Of y0. That's different than the variance and independent of d.
I don't see that.
What you have above is D. What you put with the condition that you wrote down is saying the covariance between delta and y0 is zero. But that's about independence between Y1 minus Y0 and Y0, not D.
Yeah, that's perhaps a reasonable point. I will clean that up.
And it can't, what you have can't be, Y1 and 0 are just labels.
I'm not sure what you mean by that.
I mean, I could change what I call the treatment and what I change the control without changing that model, but that is a different implication.
Yeah, well, then this is going to be, all the deltas are going to be negative, right? I don't see how it's going to turn.
I think the independence assumption you need is Y0, not D.
I will think about it more. The point I want you to take away is not that I was not sufficiently precise, but that there's this test, and then more generally, that's on the next slide. Even though this gets assumed in these particular contexts, it's hard to see why this would ever be true assumption, right? If you have a voluntary program, and many of the things that we study are voluntary, and people have any idea what their impact is, they're going to select on it. And if they select it in the program based on their impact, then this assumption is false. So I'm always surprised that people don't see, especially the people in the education literature, which is where I showed up, aren't bothered by this. It seems like a very stark and obvious conflict with the simplest possible economic model of treatment that we're looking at. Chris is still frowning. All right, let's see. All right, we'll talk a little bit about subgroups and we'll break. So, people routinely do subgroups, and I don't like the way they do it, so I'm going to try to convince you not to like the way they do it, too. What do I mean by subgroups here? There's a publication from the U.S. Department of Labor from the 90s when Larry Katz was the chief economist at the Department of Labor, and this labor economist slumming it in D.C. called What Works for Whom? And the idea was to take a bunch of Department of Labor programs, estimate the effect of the program, and allow the treatment effect to vary with the observed characteristics of the people being served. So for an example, this job creating partnership act experiment that I mentioned, it found much larger impacts for adult participants than for youth participants. The result of that finding was that the youth part of the program had its budget cut by 90%, which was several hundred million dollars. So that's a real policy action in response to subgroup heterogeneity and treatment effects. Why would we care about subgroups? One reason is statistical treatment rules. I mentioned these before. Here's a list of places where statistical treatment rules are actually used in a U.S. context. So this worker profile of the reemployment services system, that's that program that assigns people to services based on their estimated need for those services, as proxied by the probability that they will exhaust their unemployment insurance benefits. There was a program in Canada, never actually got implemented, but they wanted to do it, my first ever consulting project actually. It's called the Service Outcome Measurement System. And they try to estimate the impacts of every different service offered by Canada's active labor market program for many different subgroups, and then predict for any given client who came in which service they should be assigned to based on that model. It's kind of one vast, not very well thought out regression model. There's an enthusiasm in the education world called response to intervention that seeks to assign children to particular interventions based on their prediction of impacts. My colleague, Susan Murphy, she does sequential, multiple random assignment, randomized trials for SMART. You can see that it's they had to work hard to get it to spell out SMART. It's kind of awkward. She's studying the mental health world, where they actually use sequences of the way they can do multiple sequenced randomized trials, which are kind of cool, and she has looked at statistical treatment rules for mental health treatments based on these sequences of randomized trials. in the world of criminology, so I have one criminology paper with my friend John Bushway, they do what's called selective incapacitation. So they try to predict when somebody comes up for parole, for example, how likely they are to commit more crimes if they're allowed to go back into the community, and they give parole to the ones who are predicted to commit more crimes. So they're selectively incapacitating people who are predicted based on a statistical model to commit more crimes. All of these different things are basically using subgroup estimates from some design-based evaluation, good or bad, to assign people to some service, or service is broadly interpreted here to include being held in prison. So I have a survey of this literature with a Danish, he was a graduate student at the time, not a graduate student anymore, that hopefully gets finished this fall while I'm on sabbatical. If you're really interested in this stuff, email me, and I will send you the survey. I don't have it on my webpage. It's kind of, it's there is a complete paper, but it's a little rougher than I like to put on my webpage, but I have circulated it even for one thing that I do in this Jabari and Smith paper, and if other Bill-Bacher points, I'll also do in one of their papers, is to think about partitioning the variance of the treatment effects into systemic and idiosyncratic components. The systemic component is the part that varies with observed characteristics. The idiosyncratic component is what's left over. So obviously this partition depends on what observed characteristics you have in your data that you choose to use for subgroups. We go through an exercise in Jabari and Smith, using the data from the Progressa conditional cash transfer program in Mexico, where we take out a lot of systematic variation in the treatment effects, and then we redo the exercise of constructing the lower bound on the impact variance, with the idea that we want to see, okay, we've used the observed variables that we have that we think are plausible for subgroups, we've taken out those subgroup effects. How much of the lower bound on the impact variance have we sort of sucked up? And it turned out that the answer was not very much, which was a little disappointing to us, but sort of suggested to us the value of thinking harder about potential subgroups at the data collection stage. I'll say a little bit more of that in a second. I'm going to do this slide and we'll take a break in a little bit. It struck me, and actually I think this is something that I've thought about because of this class. So the last 2 years in Beijing, one of the lecturers was Mark Rosenzweig. And he presented a paper that had something in it that I realized I'd never really seen before. It was a theory of subgroup differences. Right, so he had this theory of why education should have a different impact in a particular context in Africa on men and women. And he had, you know, he had a formal theory model. And I thought, wow, how many actual formal models of subgroup effects have I ever seen? And the number that came to my head was zero, other than what was quite paper. Now, sometimes you'll see kind of very informal descriptions of why you might see effects between men and women and stuff. But certainly in the job training program literature, the active labor market program literature, there's kind of this folk wisdom about which variables even interact with the treatment indicator. But they're never justified in a formal way. Oftentimes, they're never explicitly justified at all. And that strikes me as very bad practice. It especially strikes me as bad practice if it's true in general, and I haven't done this in general, so I don't know, but if it's true in general, what was true in the progressive data, that the observed variables that we traditionally use to do subgroup effects don't actually capture a lot of the variation of the treatment effect. Right? Then we should be thinking a lot harder about where we think variation in the treatment effect would come from. That's something that theory can help us with. And then we should think about how to measure those variables that our theory tells us might be important. Because they might be variables that we're not presently including in our survey. That seems to me huge opportunity for research. I will highlight these two other papers and then we'll break. This is yet another Filler-Gelbach Points paper. You can see I like their sequence of papers. This is probably my favorite one of the bunch. It's in the American Economic Review. They have a model of quantile treatment effects, right? So they're studying the standard kind of welfare or work decision using this welfare reform evaluation, experimental evaluation. And their very simple model gives them predictions for heterogeneous treatment effects at different quantiles of the outcome distribution. And then they take their predictions to the data by looking at the quantile treatment effects and indeed find support for their theory. It's a really slick paper. This more recent paper, and this should be 2016, but it's now published, also in the AER, by Pat Klein and Melissa Tartari. They also use advanced outsource data, and they take the model, but instead of using the model to make predictions about quantile treatment effects, they use the model to impose restrictions on the joint distribution. So I think of their paper as being a very cool risk on Melissa Clements. I don't think that's how they think of their paper, but that's one way to think about it. It is a model-based way of placing restrictions on the joint distribution that narrows the set of possible treatment effects heterogeneity. This too is a very cool paper. It's one of my favorites in the last few years. So I'm going to trim some of this lecture to this part so we can get to the second part. So I want to do some of the second part. So I'll go back to the subgroups and say a little bit. So, are subgroup effects common? The first question I want to ask. And what do I mean by that? One way, so as I mentioned, the vast majority of the literature on program evaluation, broadly conceived, thinks of that a common effect model, period. Everybody has the same effective treatment, or every human has the same effective treatment. Of the remainder, some decent fraction thinks about there being subgroup effects, but that within subgroups, the effect of the treatment is common. And this is pretty important if you want to think about doing statistical treatment rules, which I talked about right before the break. The statistical treatment rules, to be sensible, really rely on the idea that, you know, this subgroup has this effect and this subgroup has this effect, and that those effects are common to all members of the subgroup. And that doesn't have to be true. And if it is not true, it can just be a spread. And I've made a very simple example. So suppose that our subgroups are men and women, and half of men have an impact of 10, and half have an impact of 4. Half of women have an impact of 12, and half have an impact of 1. And suppose that they all know their impacts, and that the cost of participation is 5. Right, well, what happens is that half of the men participate, and half of the women participate. And let's suppose that we do a randomized trial, or some other convincing non-experimental identification strategy, and we correctly estimate the two different impacts for men and women, and we say, aha, this program works better for women. Our policy prescription is that we subsidize the rest of the women to be in the program. The rest of the women have an impact of 1, but if we pay them 5, cover the cost of the program, they will show up. But that is not a good policy. Right? And it's not a good policy because it's run afoul of the fact that the subgroup impacts are not actually common. So, when you read the literature, ask yourself about that. What if this subgroup has a distribution of impacts and the people in this subgroup are selecting based on that distribution? And what if that selection process is different across subgroups, perhaps because costs or opportunity costs differ across the subgroups? Are subgroup effects structural? So I'm going to define structural here as policy invariant. Be much less deep about it than first one. Subgroup effects can be common or structural or both or neither. Right? Why could they be, well, I've just said why they could be common or not. Why might they or might they not be structural? Well, think back to the paper a couple days ago, right, about, I'm trying to remember the exact context, but it was about explaining this institution about men and women and who did the farming and who didn't the farming. And I raised an objection and said, well, but it's not really whether you're male or female that determines your productivity in the field. It's your upper body strength. And there might be women that have high upper body strength and men that have lower upper body strength. In that context, what I had in mind was a model where the structural subgroup effects were based on upper body strength. But upper body strength is correlated with this variable, whether you're male or female or not. So in that sense, the male-female subgroup effects are not structural. because they don't correspond to the strategic generating process, the policy invariant generating process, because we can do a policy that bulked up all the women, and then the male-female subgroup effects would change, even though the upper body subgroup effects would not have changed, because they are policy invariant. Okay? That's another thing to think about here. You will see very little of this kind of discussion in any program evaluation paper that estimates subgroup effects. There's never a consideration, never is too strong, but very rarely a consideration that the subgroup variable that we happen to have in the data or happen to choose to interact with the treatment indicator may be proxying for some other characteristic that is actually the one that has the structural treatment effect difference. This is all very important if we want to think about statistical treatment rules or if we want to understand how programs work and how they work differently for different people. All right, I went through this. There's a lot of opportunities for writing papers with models of subgroup differences in the effects of policy. Now I've got to decide what to do. I think I'm going to question this slide effects, even though it makes my heart sore. But you can read it. And I'm going to cut that analysis, and I'm going to cut that. And I want to say a little bit about classical statistics, and then a little bit about GE, and then I'm going to do the discussions of the study. So an issue that has become very important, especially in the world of randomized trials in development economics, but also to some degree in the world of randomized trials in education, which is a big world in the US because the Department of Education now spends quite a lot of money on randomized trials, is the concern that if you estimate enough subgroup effects, some of them will turn out to be statistically different from zero, even if in the population all of them are in fact zero. So, for example, 5% of them, if you use a 5% cutoff for statistical significance, if you estimate 100 subgroup effects, you would expect to get around 5 that are statistically significant at the 5% level, even in the world where there are no subgroup differences in the treatment effect. And that's a concern because people believe, I think with some justification, that researchers think that clients want some stars. They want some statistically significant impacts on somebody. Maybe the overall treatment effect doesn't have any stars, darn it, but maybe for some subgroups we can get some hope so that we can have a press release about how the program shows promising results for, you know, people of Aztec ancestry living in Wyoming, or whatever subgroup it is that turns out to have statistically significant impact. As a reaction to that, several responses have emerged in the recent literature, and I want to briefly describe those. The classical response is to formally adjust the p-values for multiple comparisons. So there's an older strategy called Bonferroni strategy. There's a more recent strategy called, that's named after Benjamini and Hochberg. My friend and fellow Heckman student Peter Sochet has a nice survey piece that they've identified audience. I'm happy to send it to you. You can't find it yourself, that he did for the Institute for Education Sciences, that sort of lays out these different traditional statistical methods for adjusting the p-values to deal with multiple comparisons. That's the formal statistical name of this problem, is that if we're doing lots and lots of comparisons, some of them are going to be statistically different from zero, even if none of them are different from zero in the population. A second strategy that has been adopted by the Institute for Education Sciences for the evaluations that they do is that they force you ex ante to divide your subgroups into two groups called confirmatory and exploratory. Confirmatory are supposed to be the ones that you have some reason to think that there might actually be subgroup differences there. And the typical justification is that somebody else found a subgroup difference in an earlier evaluation. Exploratory ones get segregated into a different section, and they're supposed to be more speculative, and they're supposed to provide the basis for further analysis in later evaluations, but they're not supposed to be stressed in the current evaluation. They require you to do multiple comparisons adjustments for these, but not for these. And so that gives the firm that's doing the evaluation a strong incentive to limit the number of variables, the number of subgroups that are stuck into the confirmatory category. it imposes this cost. If you move them over here, then you get to make policy statements about them at the end, but the more of these you have, the more your multiple comparisons corrections are going to bite. In development economics land, the randomistas have got this thing now where you submit a pre-analysis plan. The American Economic Association runs a repository for these pre-analysis plans where you commit to the subgroups you're going to look at before you get your data. So that at the very least, somebody can say, aha, these guys said they were only going to look at these 10, but then they looked at these other 50 because they didn't get to be started at the first 10, whatever it is. Another strategy that was used in the MPO study, this is the common cycle, as I'm sure it was used before, by Plain Lehman and Katz, is to dimension reduce. And here, this is more about outcomes than about subgroups, but the multiple comparisons problem also arises in the context of outcomes. Right? If I have 100 different outcomes, you know, this bit of your health, that bit of your health, this psychometric measure, that psychometric measure, five different labor market outcomes, blah, 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 blah. Again, I may get some stars if I have enough of those, even in the world where the program actually has no impact on any of them. Plainly, then Katz advocate reduce the number of outcomes by aggregating measures into indices. So dimension reduction, that's called. All are reasonable things. To me, these are all solutions to a problem that arises only because economics and policymakers and students and pretty much everybody else doesn't do classical statistical testing right. They do the test right, they don't interpret them correctly. They take them too seriously, they didn't really write it too literally, I don't know, whatever. And a lot of this has to do with confusing statistical significance with substantive significance and sort of not being as informally Bayesian as I would think. There is no reason to privilege zeros and null.
No.
You all know this, everybody knows this from their undergrad econometrics class, but nobody does it, or most people don't do it, and I find it very frustrating. You know, you can listen to a whole talk where substantive significance is never mentioned once. Right? What is the magnitude of the coefficient? What does it mean? And only significance means statistical significance. Well, statistical significance is nice, it tells us something about how precise the coefficient is. But we actually care, usually. Sometimes you don't. If it's a really narrow theory testing context, you won't care about the sign. But for most real-world applications, and program evaluation context in particular, you care about the magnitude. Why do we just do this binary accept-reject thing? So you can read papers that don't even put the standard errors in, or the p-values. They just have the stars. So all you know is this semi-order, right? You don't know if the p-value was 0.06, or 0.92, well that makes a difference. You can have precise simulation. Rant. Second point I want to make. This is a super big, broad, methodological point. But again, I think it's completely uncontroversial at some level. I don't think any of you are going to disagree with it. But it's something that we're not very good at in this point. I don't have a, there's no simple solution here. But I think it's important and should be at least thought about by empirical researchers. And that is that standard errors only capture one source of uncertainty in estimates, in empirical estimates. Right? So that I got to thinking about this because I wrote this paper with my student, Shannon Seitz, my graduate student, Jeremy Lees. It's a general equilibrium evaluation of a program. And so we're being macroeconomists here, basically. We write down a search model, we calibrate the search model, like macro people do. And then we had this big discussion about, should we have standard errors on the numbers that come out of our calibration exercise? Now, it's normative in that world not to have standard errors, but there is a subset of macro people who do standard errors on the calibrated estimates. So they sort of, they've got these moments they're using to do the calibration, those moments have standard errors. And you can kind of run that uncertainty through the nonlinear model, and it pops out as standard errors on the output of your calibration. And we had this long discussion about whether or not we should do this. And I was advocating that we should do it, and the co-authors were advocating that we shouldn't do it, but really Shannon was, because Jeremy was just a student, and so he was keeping quiet. And finally, we came up with this compromise, which is this long footnote, where we said, look, we could put in standard errors, we're not going to. And the reason we're not going to is that we think that the uncertainty in our estimates that's due to the sampling variation in the moments that we use in the calibration is dwarfed by the model uncertainty. Right? And in a sense, this is the way I kind of reconcile myself to not presenting the standard errors. And I think it's a reasonable way to reconcile yourself with that. You know, we examined the sensitivity of our calibrated values to two out of the eight or nine things that we calibrated. The two that seem most dodgy, the one we were taking from Denmark and the other one. We did not examine the sensitivity estimates in model space at all. This is not something you do in macro, or you do it across papers instead of within papers. But you could imagine kind of tweaking details of the model and seeing how much it changes the results. We didn't do that. That would be something people should do. You're probably saying, why is this in this talk? Okay? It's in this talk, so I think it's important, and it's a chance for everything. This is really important. Standard errors really understate our degree of ignorance about the stuff that we estimate. I know it's kind of negative things to say. And especially, I think, the structural estimation, but in design-based estimation, too, there's lots of other sources of uncertainty that we routinely ignore. All right, we'll talk about that. We're going to talk about that later. I'm not going to talk about that. Last thing I want to talk about in these slides is just very briefly make a pitch for general equilibrium evaluation. So, what if SIPPA fails? Probably SIPPA usually fails. Maybe it doesn't always fail in a way that's that important to the results of the evaluation, but in some cases it might be. There's some evidence that it could be. In my world of active labor market programs, broadly conceived, there's two strategies that people have used to try to get to the limit of them. One is to sort of do a design-based analysis where the unit of analysis is the local labor market. Right? So there's this amazing paper, Crippon, Bergon, Rapidot, I don't know how to say that in French, Zamora, got the French government to this, only Esther could pull this off, got the French government to do two-level random assignment of an active labor market. So the first thing they randomly assigned at the jurisdiction level was the fraction of eligible people who would receive the program. Then within each jurisdiction, they randomly assigned eligibles to the program in the randomly selected proportion. Right? What does that let you do? Well, that gives you a compelling estimate of the impact of the program at each of these different local labor markets, because you've done random assignment in each labor market. And then you can take the labor market specific estimates and you can look at them as a function of the fraction of people who randomly assigned. Right? And if you think spillovers are important, then those impacts should be declining in the fraction randomly assigned. And that is what they do in DFINE. That's a very compelling estimate, and it's using this strategy of variation in treatment intensity, occurring variation in treatment intensity across relatively isolated local labor markets. Unfortunately, soon to be former colleague Manuela Angelucci and her graduate school colleague Giacomo Di Giorgio have this really nice paper that does a similar exercise using the data from the Progressa conditional cash transfer program. Their random assignment took place in isolated villages. In each village, they surveyed not only eligible people but ineligible people. And so you can estimate the gender equilibrium effects by doing treatment effects on the ineligible people in the treated villages compared to the ineligible people in the control villages. And they do a lot more than that because they try to trace out kind of paths operating through family networks and things like that. But again, it's this strategy of using geographic heterogeneity in isolated markets to generate variation in the treatment intensity as a way of getting the gender equilibrium effects. You're not always going to have this variation. So what the rest of the literature does is it writes down a structural equilibrium model. George Johnson, used to be in Michigan, has some very, very old school. When you read these papers, they seem really old. And it helps to describe them. It's not the style in which people write papers anymore. Early general equilibrium evaluations like this. Davidson and Woodbury, they're up in Michigan State, have this really nice equilibrium search paper that looks at the UI bonus experiments. UI bonus said, if you, see UI claimants, if you get a job within, I think it was 10 weeks, we'll give you $500. That's the bonus. If you get off UI fast, we'll give you a cash reward. And they do an equilibrium evaluation, and they show their search model that this program should have effects on the search intensity. So this is a Reed's chapter 6 model, or whatever it is, in which people are choosing search intensity in the labor market, that this program increases the search intensity of the people who are eligible for the bonus, but it also affects the optimal search intensity of everybody else in the labor market, both people who aren't eligible for unemployment insurance and people who didn't manage to find a job in the period in which the bonus was available. And they argue that a substantial but not overwhelming fraction of the partial equilibrium treatment effect is undone by this unemployment. So that paper was the direct inspiration for this paper that I mentioned before, the Lee Sykes and Smith paper. Hacker and Lochner paper, and this actually isn't the wrong site here at this point, is they're looking at the effect of a $500 a year subsidy to university tuition. And their idea, this is a much more ambitious paper than any of the rest of these. Any person here is a laborer there, is my sense. Their argument is centered on relative skill prices, right? So if we take a bunch of people, there's two kinds of skill in the market, people with college degrees and people without, and we take the people from without and move them to the with, then skill prices should change in equilibrium, right? Because we increase the supply of one kind of labor and decrease the supply of the other. That's the equilibrium effect. It's not going to be captured by a partial equilibrium evaluation that just looks at a handful of people who get a subsidy and thereby increase their education level. And they argue that 90% of the partial equilibrium effect is undone by these general equilibrium effects operating through equilibrium skill prices. So a really nice paper, and again, the RAD paper is at a different time. If you're interested, I'm happy to send it to you. And my student, Jan Pluska, has a search model paper that tries to evaluate the U.S. Employment Service program, the Journal of Human Capital. This is a decent fraction of all of these papers of this sort that do general equipment evaluation program. This is another area where, to me, there's huge unplowed fields of research to do. And I think part of the reason that people haven't plowed these fields is that it kind of requires two skill sets or two interests that a lot of people don't have both of: program evaluation and equilibrium modeling. And it is also, and I will warn you if you think about doing this, that the reference part of why this is still unpublished, because this is a 2004 NER Oregon paper, it has a bunch of sites, it's got like 150 Google sites, it's very nice, is that we would send it to journals and we'd get one referee who was clearly a kind of a macro person, and they would have one set of comments. Then we get another referee who's a program evaluation person, and they would have another set of comments that at best was uncorrelated with the comments. And, sometimes they were negatively correlated. And that made perfect sense, right? Because the thing about the paper that's going to bug a macro person is very different than the thing about the paper that's going to bug somebody who's used to doing design-based project evaluation. So, not as easy to publish, but as Chris mentioned, there's this nice Todd Wolpen paper that's sort of like this. It's a partial equilibrium structural model. They managed to get that published in AR. They started about the same time as the design. It's very embarrassing that 12 years later we saw it published. Oh well. All right, summary and conclusion from this part of the talk. Experiments are not a substitute for thinking. This is a saying of my friend Bert Barnum. It's really important. Just because you didn't experiment doesn't mean you don't have to worry about the economics and the measurement and this and that and all these kind of other things. Yes, it is very nice to have exogenous variation that you have created yourself, right? We're talking about unnatural experiments here, not natural ones. It's very nice to have unnatural experiments where you were in charge of the variation, but you still have to do some economics and some kind of things. I think that this idea of bounding the variance of the treatment effects is underdone. It surprises me that it's not routinely done, because I don't think the common effect model is ever true. And I think think every time, that's my probably a bold prediction, that every time we test this, we'll reject that null. But I'd like to see more people do it. Maybe I'm wrong. Subgroup effects more subtle than they might seem, then equilibrium effects have been really important in our study. Any questions on this part of the talk before I launch into the study zone? There he is. That's a good picture, actually. It's an experience good. There's no real way to describe it. That was my perception. I'm glad I did it, but it's hard to describe. All right, lessons from experiments. I actually want to think about this as lessons from within study design. So, what is a within study design? A within study design is a paper that uses an experimental evaluation as a benchmark, as truth, against which to judge the performance of a non-experimental identification strategy applied using particular data in a particular programmatic context. This nomenclature, this term of within study designs, comes from outside of economics. I think it comes from Tom Cook, who's a very big deal in the education evaluation world. I don't really like it. I think we're stuck with it. I don't really like it. The reason I don't like it is it's not always really within. And I'm going to talk about the Lalonde 1986 paper. So a lot of this talk is going to be about, this part of the talk is going to be about my reinterpretation of this one very important, highly cited paper. It had a very big influence in labor economics, and particularly a very big influence in program evaluation part of labor economics. By Robert Lalonde in 1986, the lead article in the American Economic Review. In his context, and I will show you, it's not clear that within study design is a good name, but that's what Tom calls these things, and I think that's understood. I'm going to argue that the literature fundamentally misinterprets the knowledge that we gain from this set of studies. And I'm going to try to lay that out in some detail. I think I've got about 45 or 50 minutes to do that. And, am I up 32 minutes today? And we'll see if you like it. And I'm going to be giving a similar talk in Australia in 10 days, so I'd be interested to know your reaction. So I'm not going to go through all these parts. What I'm going to do is I'm going to march through this literature. It's a really fun literature to teach because it's a sequence of papers, starting with the Lalonde 1986 papers, his dissertation, that all build on one another. Each responding. It's the way science is supposed to work in some sense, right? Somebody writes a paper, somebody else writes a paper responding to it, refining it, boom, 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 down the road up to this paper of mine with a student that we wrote last summer. I think this sounds really cool. I hope you will too. All right. Lalonde 86, his dissertation. Here's what he says. The goal of paper is to assess the likely ability of several econometric methods to accurately assess the economic benefits of employment and training programs. The key term here, that. Is that an identification strategy or an estimate? That's the first issue I'm going to have with this. What he means here is identification strategy. Some of the later papers in this sequence are going to be an estimator. Those are different things. Let me give you an example. I might say that I'm going to assume the conditional dependence assumption. A lot of this literature is going to be about the conditional dependence assumption with some particular set of X variables. Given that I'm willing to do that, I can then try to estimate the average treatment effect on the treated using a parametric linear regression model or using matching. Okay? Those are two different estimation strategies that both build on the same identification assumption. They're both assuming selection on observed variables in the language of Heckman-Raub. They would say selection on observables. They would say selection on observed variables. But there are different estimators with different properties, and you can tell stories, and indeed in this case some of those stories are true in this particular data set, about why matching might work better than a parametric linear model in certain data generating processes. Not mentioned here in the Lalonde setup is the data. That's the direction that I'm going to go. So I'm going to juxtapose the data and the methods. The interpretation of this literature has largely been that it's informing us about methods. Right? So that's how Lalonde frames the study. We're going to learn about which econometric methods work and which don't, because we're looking for a magic bullet, a method that we can always use that will always solve the selection problem. Wouldn't that be great to have that magic bullet? You can look at the text. Here's two recent papers. This is Howard Bloom at ERC, Charles Mizlopoulos, Carolyn Hill at Georgetown, Chicago, PhD, Hollister and Wilder. They're smart folks, no slouches. But this is how they frame their within study designs as well. Right? Their studies that use an experiment as a benchmark to study the effect of non-experimental identification strategies applied to particular data in particular program contexts. So what's the setup in Lalonde? So there's two really early experiments in the US. One of them, which is a set, is the negative income tax experiments. That's not what we're talking about here. The other is the so-called National Support of Work Demonstration. The National Support of Work Demonstration provided a very generous treatment that in current dollars would cost about $15,000 per participant. Whereas the Workforce Investment Act, which is the current training program in the US, spends about $3,000 per participant. It's a very expensive treatment to people in four groups that I will define in a second. And they did a randomized trial. And at that time, this was, as I say, one of the first couple of randomized trials of social programs anywhere, specifically in the US, but also anywhere. So he's got that. Bob's got that in his pocket. That's truth. Got the experiment. That's what we treated here. It's the benchmark. It's truth. We did an experiment. We did science. Right? And then he's going to take two comparison groups. So groups of non-participants that were not created through randomization. One of those groups is going to come from the panel study of income dynamics. And one of them is going to come, they're both from the panel study of income dynamics. And the other is going to come from the current population survey. So these are two big population surveys in the US. The CPS, lots of countries do labor force surveys just like those. A lot of countries have analogs to the panel study of income dynamics. This is a long panel that includes refresher samples that they try to follow, and sometimes you see them following for a very long time. That was kind of standard practice in program evaluation in the late 70s and early 80s, was to use these big population data sets. There are issues with that. Training participation isn't measured very well in them, for one thing, so you may have a contaminated comparison group. You would be unlikely to do this in that. And then we'll create some subsets of these two groups as well. So he has actually four, I think, panels that he didn't come in. And as comparison groups get increasingly smaller as he imposes additional screens, same thing with the CPS. I'm going to focus mainly on the broadest of the comparison groups. All right, so this expensive treatment was assigned to four different groups: people with labor market difficulties, long-term welfare recipients, the welfare program in the U.S. for single moms at the time, you have to see, high school dropouts, ex-convicts, so criminals who had, well, people who had been sent to jail and been released, and ex-addicts, people who had drug issues, but were in recovery at the moment. Lalonde takes these two groups, or these four groups, and collapses them into two. One group is just the AFPC recipients. You could keep that group as it is. I'm fine with that. The other group consists of the men from the high school dropouts. These are about half women and half men. The women are prosthetized and not used. And then the ex-convicts and the ex-addicts are almost all men. Men commit almost all crimes in the US. It's not clear why you would want to do that. No formal justification is given in the paper other than some suggestion that it makes the sample size bigger. But these are quite different. You know, high school dropouts are distinct from the population, but they're a much more general group than either ex-convicts or ex-addicts, especially at this time, because this is before the era of mass incarceration, when we put almost everybody in jail. Right? Random assignment took place before you were born, so when I was in high school, January 1976 to April 1977. Random assignment took place in 10 cities around the U.S. Elon wants to look at a lot of different identification strategies. Now, he doesn't make this distinction between identification strategies and estimators. I'm just putting that on the top of his paper. He has a couple of conditional dependence assumption estimates, right? So regression estimates that build on a conditional dependence assumption. One set of covariates includes pre-programmed learnings, one set of covariates does not. I'll show you what the covariates are in a second. He does difference in differences, so he does some implied stability. He estimates the normal selection model. He does that two ways. One way is with no exclusion restriction, so it's identified solely off the functional form. Again, you see that now, you say, oh my goodness, nobody does that now. But this was 1986. Look at that in 1986. They believed everything was normal. And then he has some dubious exclusion restrictions that I will tell you about later. These are all linear periodic estimators. He uses the two-step estimator for the normal model. Right? This is the early 1980s. That's important here. Some STATA. Right? There is SAS, but you get the normal model in SAS, you have to write a big long program in the SAS matrix language, blah, blah, blah. What are the covariates here? Age, indicators black and Hispanic, years of schooling, indicator variable for being married, and an indicator variable for high school completion. That's the X. Now think about that, right? Think about the men in particular. You've got this group that consists of high school dropouts, ex-convicts, and ex-addicts. And your comparison group consists of men drawn from the CPS or the PSID, the general population. Maybe you've thrown out the college graduates or something, one of his sub-comparison groups. And you're arguing, although no formal argument is made in the paper, that by conditioning on this stuff, you produce a legitimate comparison between the guys drawn from the population as a whole and this choice-based sample of ex-addicts, ex-convicts, and dropouts, right? Where ex-addicts and ex-convicts are way overrepresented relative to the dropouts, relative to their population proportion. Really? Okay. Maybe we add in one period of lag earnings, and I'll say more about the lag earnings in a second. Outcome variable. The treatment group outcome variable is taken from the survey that was part of the National Supportive Work Demonstration Evaluation. It measures earnings in one particular way. The CPS comparison group, their earnings data came from the Social Security Administration, which measures earnings in a different particular way. The PSID comparison group, their earnings come from the PSID survey, which measures earnings in a different way from the National Supportive Work Demonstration Survey. So measurement differences in the outcome variable, which might be systemic, are being conflated with treatment group status. That's unattractive. The dependent variables real remains in 1979, were random assignments in 76 and 77, so we're waiting a while. The treatment lasted about 9 months if you went all the way through it. The lag dependent variable is real earnings in 1975. Now, for the PSID people, right, you start that, there's a timing issue here for the comparison group about when you measure the decision to participate, right? You need to align the comparison group in time. And they're aligned relative to January 1976, which is what Randall Climate started. So for them, earnings in 1975 are earnings in the year before they made the treatment choice. For the people who were randomly assigned in January 1976, earnings in 1975 are earnings in the year before they made the treatment choice. For people who were randomly assigned in January 1977, earnings in 1975 are earnings a year before they made the treatment choice. And so if you thought that the conditional dependence assumption was plausible with these variables plus a year of life earnings, you would think it was much more plausible for the people randomly assigned early, for whom this earnings measure is right before the participation choice, than for people randomly assigned later in the random assignment period, for whom this may be a year or even 18 months before they make the decision to double their participation. More generally, the alignment of the lag-dependent variable, which is the key, the literature is very clear, that is the key conditioning variable, if you're going to assume conditional dependence in an evaluation delivery program. The alignment is different for the treated units and the untreated units. So again, you may be conflating a difference in the way you set up your design disalignment choice with an actual treatment. That's unattractive. What are the candidate exclusion restrictions that that LaVon is for? Employment status in January 1976. Well, that doesn't seem like it should be excluded when random assignment starts in January 1976. AFDC status in 1975. That's kind of serially correlated. That doesn't seem too reasonable. Now, number of children is defensible in the sense that there used to be a lot of labor supply studies that used the number of children as an instrument. I don't think that's something we would do anymore for a whole lot of reasons that we could discuss after. The really troublesome one is this one here, urban residency. Now remember, supported work was operated in 10 locations, all of which were in cities. Right? So what happens if you, in this case, me, go to replicate LaVon's analysis and you type in this data, probe it, are you treated or not, and you put an urban dummy in. So data comes back and said, urban perfectly predicts participation, variable drops. Right? Everybody in the treatment group is in a city because that's where the experiment was run. Whatever Fortran program or SAS program Bob was using to do this, it didn't check. So who knows what it did? Because he produces estimates that purportedly use urban residents as an exclusion restriction. This is why replication is useful. All right, I'm not going to, this is way too small, this is page above the paper. These numbers vary wildly. That is the point I want to make, and that is the point that Bob wanted to make. The non-experimental impact estimates vary widely across identification strategies. They vary widely across comparison groups. Sometimes the PSID looks good, sometimes the CPS looks good, sometimes the subsets look good. Bob does a limited set of kind of specification tests plus a little bit of casual throwing out for various reasons, and concludes that this strategy does not eliminate, and that should be identification strategies, does not eliminate all the poorly performing identification strategies. So then he says, okay, that means we need to do experiments. This is part of where the credibility revolution came from, this paper. When I go back in time before Angrist and that whole crowd, this paper was very important in setting the credibility revolution in motion. Because in this literature, it caused people to really, really, really be dubious about anything except randomized control trials. So here's Bob's words. Policymakers should be aware that the available non-experimental evaluations may contain large and unknown biases resulting from specification errors. Now that's an odd term, because what it really means is identification strategy choice. If you think about that as a specification error. Yes, absolutely. But the paper was interpreted as meaning we got to do experiments. Now, interestingly, it was only interpreted that way in the both active labor market programs. Although it's not clear why it should be limited, why it shouldn't extend to other empirical literatures. And it had a real world effect. When they went to design the evaluation of the Job Training Partnership Act, which happened in the late 1980s, the Lawn paper was circulating. It was very much on their mind. Said, oh wow, we can't evaluate JTPA using these non-experimental methods because Lawn has showed, and it got in the AR, the lead article in the AR, that they're rubbish, at least in this context, and so we've got to do a randomized trial. And thereby resulted in all these papers that Chris and I and other people wrote. Here's the alternative interpretation of the paper that I want to sell you. At a price of zero, or I guess at your time. But I think it's worth more than you're paying for it. I want to argue that the problem here is not the identification strategy, it's the data. Now, I was kind of pinning that as I went along in a not very subtle way by mocking certain features of the analysis. Why would you expect a handful of conditioning variables here to satisfy the conditional dependence assumption? Especially for the men, right? Where you have these ex-convicts, and yet, you have no variables related to crime. You have ex-addicts, and yet you have no variables related to substance use. Right? If a student came in to you and said, aha, I'm going to do a selection on the third variable strategy and look at the effect of something, you know, that treats ex-addicts and uses a comparison group, a random sample of the population, and I don't have any conditioning variables related to substance use, you would say, no, you are not going to do that, because no one will. But that's what he does, right? I talked about this alignment problem already. When you think about all these problems with the data, why do you blame the message, right? The message that the literature took away from this was, oh, can non-experimental identification strategies don't work, non-experimental evaluation strategies don't work when you apply them to data that are rubbish. And I think it's the latter of those two conclusions that is the one that you should take away from. That garbage in, garbage out. If you do this to bad data, it doesn't matter how much clever econometrics you have, you're not going to get good estimates out of it. Questions so far? That's kind of my, that is the biggest point. There's some more points coming, so that is the biggest point I want you to take away from this part of the lecture and from the launch paper discussion in particular, that the literature interpreted this about as being about methods, and I think you should interpret it as being about data. Okay. Next paper is Heckman Hunt. They come along. And as you know, this is my committee, so it's all very incestuous here, right? Heckman Hunt's in Milan. So they use, and they were writing this while I was in graduate school before I started working with Jim. They take and use all administrative data for everybody. So they solve the problem with the outcomes are measured. By using administrative data for everybody. The cost of that is they can only look at the CPS comparison group, and because the data are grouped for confidentiality reasons, they can't look at nonlinear estimators, so they can't do the bivariate normal model. There's a lot of attrition in the NSW survey data, so their sample's actually a lot bigger than the Lalonde sample. So I wish they'd kind of gone through and done everything for the Lalonde sample and for the full sample, so you would know how much of this was sample and how much of those other things they're doing, but they didn't do that, or they did and they put in the paper. So they do conditional dependence assumption, they do difference in differences, and they do what they call the random growth model, which is estimating a unit-specific slope coefficient for every unit, which allows the selection on growth rates, as well as selection on levels. What do they find? That they can reject all of the, that should be, identification strategies that differ in both signs, statistical significance from the experiment. Within that set, there's still some variation in magnitudes, not surprisingly, but they argue that they've gotten rid of sort of all the really awful estimates that give a different qualitative conclusion than what you get out of the experiment. They do that in part by doing a systematic battery of what you might call placebo tests. Right, the one that they highlight most strongly is the so-called pre-programmed test, where they apply the estimator, because they have multiple pre-programmed periods in the administrative data, they can apply, for example, the difference in differences strategy to two pre-programmed periods and compare the resulting estimate to zero. Because in the pre-programmed, right, if you're doing difference in differences with two pre-programmed periods, you know what the right answer is, because nobody's been treated yet, you know that it's zero. And so they do those tests, and they do some other tests over identifying restrictions. Their line, which is interesting in a sense, since Jim has to some degree soured against on these tests in more recent years, their line is if you take the specification strategy, testing strategy more seriously than Lalonde did, you could actually clean out a lot of that estimate. Now, partly they're helped here by the fact that they have this admin data, which he did not use, that allows them to have more pre-programmed periods. I still kind of like the pre-programmed test. I was talking with somebody about this during the break, or about the more general category of placebo tests. I think they've proven useful. I think there's a lot more research to be done with them. Heckman and I left only two papers on the table when we stopped writing. One of the two papers that we left on the table unfinished was a paper about these tests. More to be done. Oh, we're 1 minute. 10 minutes. I just love talking about this literature, as you can probably tell. Okay, so I'm not going to touch that line. It's 10 foot pole. So as I mentioned, the design of the experimental evaluation of the Job Training Partnership Act program, which was called the National JCA Study, or NJS, was a direct response to Lalonde's paper, but it was also a response to Quinn-Hutt's. Right, so they did an experiment, a randomized trial, at 16 of the 600 program sites. And then because, so that was the response to Lalonde, they did an experiment. The response to Heckman-Hutt's was they added a non-experimental component to the study. So at 4 of the 16 sites, they collected ideal comparison group data. This is the eligible non-participant or ENP data that I showed you on the graph before. So why is this ideal? The ENPs were administered exactly the same survey as the control group. There's no worry about differences in outcome measurement. There's no worry about differences in covariate measurement. They're in the same local labor market as the control. All of the comparison group members were determined to be eligible at a specific point in time. So there's no issue, as there is in both of the Lalonde's comparison groups, that a bunch of the people in the comparison group wouldn't have been eligible for supported work. And they got really detailed data on labor market outcomes in the period immediately prior to the decision to participate in the program or not. That data on outcomes, so length, values, and why, essentially, the literature tells you are very important because they capture the action felt dip. That's why I foreshadowed that before. And they contain implicitly a whole lot of variables that are not measured explicitly. Right? How attractive you are matters in the labor market. You don't measure in these data how attractive people are, but it's implicit in their pre-programmed labor market outcomes because it affects the outcomes in the pre-program created too. So it's nice data. Heckman et al., they also use the SIP. They're trying to mimic Lalonde, right? So they get this big national data set that measures earnings differently. SIP comparison group always does badly. And then they do a whole bunch of different estimation strategies based on either conditional dependence or bias stability. So this set of papers, the set of papers that introduce difference and differences matching, that introduce to some degree matching into the economics program evaluation literature, although it's been an ongoing enterprise in statistics literature for a long time before that, and we've been in students. What do they find? Measuring the dependent variable in the same way is a good idea. I would have thought, I mean, it almost seems crazy. Right? To write in a paper or an econometric, oh, it's a good idea to measure the dependent variable the same for the treated units and the untreated units. But Lalonde didn't, and that's part of the reason why his result didn't match the experimental impacts. It turns out in this context, the local labor markets matter a lot. If you mix and match the controls and ENPs, so you take ENPs from one local labor market and controls from another, you get gigantic biases. There's something unmeasured in the JDPA context about local labor markets that's really important for comparison group selection. That's an open question in literature is what that thing means. That's something I hope to write more about. I've been surprised others have not. The CIA, it matters what you condition on. If you condition on the variables that Lalonde has, you get really big biases. Your non-experimental estimates don't come close to the experimental estimates. If you condition on a much richer set of covariates that emphasizes finely measured pre-program outcomes, then you get estimates that are close to the experimental estimates. So the CIA, right, it matters. Who would thought? It matters what you condition on. Right? And the set of variables, if you think about the model, and we go back and do that if we have more time, it's not surprising that it's the late outcomes that are really interesting here. That flows right out of the model. And you find the data. And for the reason I foreshadowed, because of the selection of the transitory component that leads to the dip, bias stability doesn't hold. Because there's selection both on time invariant components and on serially correlated transitory components. There's those graphs again. We don't need to talk about them anymore. Let me. Let me say a little bit about the Dijon Baba, and then we will wrap up. What did the Dijon Baba do? So the Dijon Baba are Harvard PhD students. They were William Linz and Rubin. And they said, we can take the Lalonde data, And instead of implementing the conditional independence assumption using experimental linear model, we will implement the conditional independence assumption using matching. And it's actually a super reasonable thing to do in this context. Their reasoning is exactly right. I don't have their graph here. Right? So here is the distribution of propensity scores. They're going to do propensity score matching. The propensity score is the conditional probability of treatment given X. And what is true for the current population survey comparison group is that basically, so there's 11,000 roughly people in the CPS comparison group for the men. Basically, 10,500 of those people don't look anything like people in supportive work. Right? If you estimate a parametric linear model, those 10,500 people who aren't in any way comparable to people in supportive work, they're driving the slope coefficients and regression because there's so many of them. If you do matching, they're thrown out because they don't look like the treated units. So this is kind of the poster child for when matching is going to make a difference relative to a parametric linear model when you're trying to estimate treatment effects, assuming selection on the third variable. The estimator, right? We're not varying. The Eastern Wild don't vary the identification strategy. They're varying the estimator. They're assuming selection of their variables, just like a log did in some of his estimates. They're switching up the estimator based on arguing about what the data generating process is like. That there's a huge number of observations in the comparison group that don't look anything like the treatment group. And it's actually going to throw those people out instead of letting them drive what the slope coefficients are. They also, and this is important, don't use all of the launch data. So this is month of random assignment. This is, actually it goes that way, calendar months. This is whether or not you have zero earnings in month 13 to 24 before random assignment. The whole rectangle is a Lons sample. They throw out this part of the Lons data on the argument that only for these people in this L shape do you really have 2 years of pre-program earnings in a loose sense. So they have changed, and they've done a bunch of things. They've changed the estimator, they've changed the sample. What did they find? I want to say what they find. They find really small biases. Right again, so within study design, they compare their non-experimental estimates now obtained using matching, assuming selection on the third variable, to the experimental estimates, and some of the differences are like $10 on experimental estimates of 1,700. That's a really small bias. So everyone's like, woo, see, no, this is great. They say the methods we suggest are not relevant in all situations. There may be unobserved covariates. Rather than giving up or relying on assumptions about the unobserved variables, right, that's a snark at the bivariate normal model, there's substantial reward for first exploring the information contained in the variables that are observed. All correct. And again, I should point out too, by the way, on your slide, that when Smith and Todd went and replicated their analysis, if you do what they did, you get what they got, which again, they said of all papers. The literature interpreted this as matching works, even in weak data context, right? Because they haven't changed the fact that we hardly have any conditioning variables at all, and that the pre-program outcome variable is crude and is not well-aligned temporally between the treated and untreated units. They didn't change that. All they did was they went from parametric linear model to matching. Not a bad thing to do in this data context. I got a paper to referee from the Review of Economics and Statistics around this time. So I went through this whole multi-year period of getting zillions of matching papers to referee, many of which were great at. And it was a paper on zoning, right, on land use. And they said, well, we're going to use matching in our study of zoning because the Hessian Wabba have shown that matching solves the selection problem. And I thought, this is completely and utterly wrong yet. Right? The Hessian Wabba don't show that matching solves the selection problem. What the Hessian Wabba show is that for their subset of the Lalonde data, the conditional dependence assumption is true. And it's less, and your estimates are improved if you do matching, for reasons that aren't surprising when you think about the way to compare it. That's what they show. They learned something about the data. They don't show, even though this is how the literature interprets their paper, that matching works in some broad metaphysical sense, in which because it worked over here, for this subset of the Lalonde data, with these variables, in this programmatic context, it's going to do work for babies or something else. All right, let me wrap up. Smith and Todd basically replicate the Egypt lava, and they show that if you do what they did, you get what they got. If you use all of the Lalonde data, you get big biased estimates. If you only use the observations that are randomly assigned in the first 4 months of random assignment, you get really big biases. That's a problem for their estimate, right? Because for these folks, their variance variables are better aligned. You would expect the biases to be smaller, but they're not. They're a lot bigger. And they show that the Hijimaba estimates are really sensitive to all kinds of different small perturbations of the empirical procedure. Like, do you estimate the propensity score using the treatment group, the control group, or both? How do you break ties in the matching? Both of those things move the estimates by hundreds of dollars. What that's telling you is that the sample's really small, which is what Michael Lechner likes to point out all the time. I would argue that A, the conditional dependence assumption does not hold for the men, at least not in the early random assignment sample or in the full data. I don't need to argue that the sample is small. It is small. We're doing semi-parametrics on a couple hundred observations in some cases here. This data set has become the canonical data to use in the embodied econometrics literature for demonstrating how estimates work. This seems to be crazy.
I agree.
Thank you. Lechner agrees too. All right, I'm not going to tell you about this paper, which is pretty fun. We can talk about it in the office. We go back. So the reason that Smith and Todd and Heesh and Wapa and all the other papers that have used the Lalonde data only look at the men is not because they're all misogynistic jerks. It's because at some point, Lalonde's analysis file for women got too close to a magnet and went away. And so he could only hand out to other people his analysis file for men. And since economists like to save on effort, that's what they did. They studied the men. So I talked a potentially foolish student, Sebastian Polonico, into going back to the raw data sources, which you can get from ICPSR, and redoing Lalonde's analysis of women from the very beginning, starting with the raw data, recreate his analysis file as best we could, do the stuff that he did, do the stuff that the Hijimaba did, do the stuff that Smith and Todd did, do the stuff that's come out of the applied econometrics literature since then, and see what we learned. What we learned basically is that the selection problem is much simpler for women in AFBC. And we kind of, there's hints of that in other literature. It's a cool paper, I'm happy to share it with you. It's also not a one page edit, it's still a little rough. All right, conclusion. Lalonde does not show the non-experimental identification strategies don't work. That's my argument. My argument is that what he shows is that the data he's using aren't very good. Indeed. But in battles between estimators and data, the data are usually going to win. The Hijimaba, I would argue, do not show that propensity score matching works in some broad metaphysical sense. I completely agree with their arguments in the supported work specific case that it makes more sense to do matching than to do a parametric linear model, given that so many of the comparison observations are incomparable. That's a big different point, and a much narrower point, than somehow matching works. We know when matching works. You can set that on the next slide, maybe it doesn't. It doesn't. When does matching work? Matching works when we have the right conditioning variables. That's what we know, right? When we have the variables that satisfy the conditional dependence assumption, matching produces consistent estimates. When we don't, it doesn't. And so the whole story here, or a lot of the story, I'm not saying again, it can make a difference in particular contexts whether you do a parametric linear model or matching. But in a broader sense, what's really important is the substance of the economics. Do we have variables that plausibly satisfy the conditional dependence assumption in a given context? You've got to make that case. And start read papers through this lens, and you'll be shocked at how many papers never explicitly justify their identification strategy. They just don't it. That's the case. That's the substance, right? That's where the economics come from. That's the sense. I'm in a very awkward place where I find both the the sort of credibility revolution people frustrating and some of the hardcore structural people frustrating. But I feel like they're both making mistakes. So. Fortunately, I mean, it seemed to be the equilibrium where most of both parties like me rather than the equilibrium where most of both parties don't. I will stop there. There's no magic bullet. The question is not about estimators. The question is about, given data, grammar, and institutional context, what's the right identification strategy? And the answer to that for a given data set, for a given set of data, maybe there isn't one. I'll stop there. Thanks very much.